Since 1972, in the days of Timothy Crouse's bestseller, The Boys on the Bus, reporters' road trips with would-be presidents have been the stuff of legend.
If your idea of a good time is flying around the country week after week, in the company of journalists and politicians, freed of all the normal strictures of daily life, in an environment where nobody's going to raise an eyebrow if you have your first drink at 11 in the morning, this is the job for you.
So we'll arrive Omaha at 6:05.
A new generation of reporters is logging thousands of miles with the candidates these days. The boys on the bus have become the more politically correct men and women. Equipped with space-age technologies, their numbers have multiplied, and they are trekking a different kind of campaign trail.
A lot of good reporters cover politics. A lot of don't want to do it anymore, though, and get out of it.
Syndicated columnist Jack Germond is covering his 10th presidential campaign.
I think it's the sort of the dehumanizing of the whole process, the isolation of the candidates, the soundbite approach.
Gone are the days of 1972, when a handful of reporters traveled with the candidates and got to know them personally.
This is, I think, the warmest winter I've spent here.
Bruce Morton, now a national correspondent for CNN, covered the 1972 race, in which George McGovern waged an uphill battle to unseat President Richard Nixon.
McGovern, I remember, was flying at some point in two little propeller planes, and we'd all swap around, so you'd spend this leg with him, and the other guy would spend the next leg with him. And the heat went out in one of them. We agreed the candidate ought to have the heated plane, as I recall. But you had that kind of access.
And they'd have dinner with you. They'd have a couple of drinks with you. They weren't afraid you were going to blow them up for one cheap story. I mean, it was an entirely different attitude.
Thank you, but thanks, everybody. Thanks.
Over the years, the proliferation of news organizations combined with satellite technology have increased the size of the press corps geometrically.
You now have these huge mobs. And what's happened, Terry, is that the crowd of reporters, of press, has become so large that it becomes a spectacle in itself.
Please, I'm asking you, please scoot over.
Seems like the number of cameras has increased mightily. I love the hardy band that stays with me through thick or thin.
Frankly, I don't feel that we see much more than people at home would see watching him on television, except glimpses here and there.
Ann Kornblum, who was not even born in 1972, is covering George W. Bush for the Boston Globe.
We don't spend a lot of time interacting with him, but we all have his speech memorized.
Being part of the pack day after day makes original reporting more difficult than it used to be.
They're all witnessing exactly the same event. They're all receiving the same handouts from the candidate staff. They're all interviewing the same people. And there's going to be a kind of sameness. There is this kind of psychology of the crowd.
Reporters must constantly guard against identifying with their candidates.
We've become captives to whatever campaign we're covering. We fly on his plane, and ride on in his motorcade, and we're pretty much insulated from the outside world.
Edwin Chen is covering the campaign of Vice President Al Gore for the Los Angeles Times.
The Stockholm Syndrome, it's hard to fight because you're in a bus surrounded by the candidate's staff, press secretaries, issues people, logistics people who can make your life so much easier.
All right, guys, we got more power bars up here if anybody's in
it. And you become a part of the entourage, whether you like it or not, by dint of physically being in this bubble.
There is, as there always has been, a certain suspension of reality on the trail.
There is definitely about the campaign a quality of summer camp, because you enter a world where you don't have to worry about getting your teeth cleaned, where you can put aside paying your bills until the indefinite future, where you're away from all the duties of family life. You know, it's a kind of prolonged adolescence.
The places we go to are blurred. It begins at 7 a.m. We've had many occasions where we don't know where we are.
Where are we?
Yeah.
Indianola.
It's a lot of cold turkey sandwiches in boxes. We've said we're not going to eat anything that doesn't have a lot of mayonnaise in it, if we can.
The food was no better in 1972, but there was a feeling of being off on your own, of being set free. Timothy Crouse traveled that year with gonzo journalist Hunter Thompson for Rolling Stone magazine.
There weren't any laptops. You didn't have a cell phone. It was a machine that we had at Rolling Stone that Hunter Thompson called the Mojo, because it wasn't even called a fax yet.
When you get on a bus now with a candidate, and there's 10 reporters and all talking on the cell phone, there's some pale desk person back in the office, you know.
People keep calling me and telling me they've sent me text pages. And
that immediate communication to the office and the world has had an impact on the news itself.
The spin cycle has so accelerated. It used to be maybe a 24-hour news cycle. Now you get something that happens early in the morning. You get a response from the opposing camp before lunch.
Certainly need to move a picture by 3 o'clock this afternoon, Central.
There is an endless cycle, a 24-hour cycle, in which somebody is always sticking a microphone in your face saying, I need to know right now, I'm live.
Is that right, Governor? You think that's fair to say?
I second that.
But are instant answers by candidates who would be president necessarily a good thing?
Eric Chevron, the old CBS commentator, used to have a saying, which was news every other day. And what he meant was sometimes you just wanted some time to think about this, you know.
And does the frenzy, the pressure of the road, reveal something about the character of a candidate?
Come on, darling. Get fired up here.
When you're president of the United States, sometimes you need to respond on the spot, whether you're dealing with Boris Yeltsin or Vladimir Putin or Saddam Hussein. You can't sit back and take polls and talk to 32 advisors and develop an issues paper. And that's part of the test.
The new technologies may also be making the bus obsolete. Campaigns more and more can communicate directly with the voter.
Well, of course, in another 4 years, it may be a virtual bus. I don't know. Really, you may be able to do a lot of this on the internet.
Ken, do I need to tell anybody in transmission?
ABC News, while covering campaign 2000 for television, is sharing costly news gathering resources with its internet site.
You know what Gore said at his thing, right?
Mark Halperin is political director for ABC News.
How do you take all that content, all that knowledge, a lot of which in the past wouldn't have made it onto ABC News, but now can be used on abcnews.com on the internet?
The network has created a central desk staffed 24 hours a day where reporters can share information on their internal campaign website.
To say that DeGore would be making news.
Information too detailed for television, but nectar for political junkies, can be displayed on abc.com.
This is Road to the White House.
With immediate access to news on cable and the internet, there is a question as to whether most journalists need to be with the candidate at all.
You could cover most stories without ever leaving Washington. It wouldn't be any fun, you know. It would be sort of bloodless, but you'd see all the stuff everybody sees.
It's a Saturday schedule if anybody needs it.
And then there is the truly heretical question. Is the race for the White House as big a story as it used to be?
The end of the Cold War means that covering presidential politics is simply less important. People are less interested in it. The stakes are not the same.
So our newspaper tries to reflect the way the country really works, and therefore the White House can end up on page 827.
And another heresy. Is there too much coverage of too little real news?
I mean, well, the interesting story, you know, is who is making a connection with the voters? Why do they like him?
Jack German says issues are not always the centerpiece of a presidential race.
Well, civil rights, that was the decisive issue for many Americans for a long time. The war in Vietnam. For some people, abortion rights, a choice, is a defining issue. But nobody's going to walk through a wall for the capital gains tax, you know.
What matters is the mettle of a man who is, as German puts it, first and foremost, good company.
You know, the dirty little secret of Reagan's presidency was most people did not agree with Reagan on his programs. They liked him, you know. It's a formless impression of somebody that is based on what they think of them as people.
And in the 2000 campaign, personality, not issues, may matter more than ever.
Partly because of the whole Clinton scandal, people care more about the honesty and the character, I think.
In the end, despite all the turkey sandwiches and sleepless nights, for most of the boys and girls on the bus,
on the road again,
the romance of the road is still there.
As messy as it is, it's a way of measuring this person who would be the most powerful man in the world.
As Timothy Crouse wrote a quarter century ago, quote, they were tired, cross, and so overworked that they could not stand another second of the campaign. And yet,
the only thing worse than covering this campaign would be not to be covering it.
They wanted it to go on forever.